Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the bank's inflation report press conference. On my left is Paul Fisher, the bank's Executive Director for Markets. On my far right is Spencer Dale, the bank's Chief Economist. Next to him is Charlie Beam, the bank's Deputy Governor for Monetary Policy. And next to me is the Governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney.
Thank you very much, Nils. Good morning, everyone. The recovery has gained momentum. Output is growing at its fastest rate since 2007. Jobs are being created at the fastest or quickest pace since records began. And after 4 years above target, the inflation rate is back at 2%. The recovery to date has been underpinned by a revival in confidence, a reduction in uncertainty, and an easing in credit conditions. And this has led households to save less and spend more, and it's prompted a strengthening in the housing market. While business investment has so far been subdued, recent data and surveys suggest that it's likely to gather pace this year. The first phase of the MPC's forward guidance was put in place last summer when, following fears of a triple-dip recession, the U.K. economy was just emerging from a long period of stagnation, persistent above-target inflation, and subdued business and household confidence. Its principal aim was to help secure the nascent recovery by reassuring households and businesses across the U.K. that the bank wouldn't raise interest rates until jobs, incomes, and spending were really growing. Specifically, the MPC set a 7% unemployment rate as a threshold for even beginning to consider whether bank rates should be raised. And that was a relatively easy call, because of the considerable slack in the economy at the time ensured that the MPC was not taking undue risks with inflation as monetary policy encouraged faster output and employment growth. Forward guidance is working. Expected interest rates have remained low, even as the economy has recovered strongly. Uncertainty about interest rates has fallen. And most importantly, UK businesses have understood the message. Surveys confirm what MPC members have heard as we travel the country. Virtually all businesses understand guidance, and almost three-quarters of them say it has boosted their confidence in UK economic prospects. In many cases, guidance is encouraging businesses to hire and to spend. It's also helped anchor inflation expectations. And finally, the forward guidance framework has highlighted a clear division of responsibilities between monetary and macroprudential policy, freeing monetary policy to focus on the inflation target in a manner that grows jobs and output without being burdened by multiple other objectives that are best addressed by more targeted measures. Now, as a result of exceptionally strong jobs growth, almost 500,000 more people have found work since August. The unemployment rate has fallen much faster than the bank had anticipated, to 7.1%, and it's likely to reach the 7% threshold by the spring. The MPC said last August that once unemployment had reached that threshold, we would assess the state of the economy more broadly, drawing on a wide array of indicators, and that assessment is provided in today's report. So the question is, what have we learned? Well, first, productivity growth has been disappointing. There remain good reasons to expect an eventual revival in productivity, but given recent outturns, the MPC has taken a more cautious approach. Productivity growth is expected to return to its pre-crisis average rate only at the end of our three-year forecast. The second thing we've learned is that there's greater slack in the labor market than we would have expected, given the very strong jobs growth. In part, this is because a substantial share of the fall in unemployment has been driven by a fall in the number of long-term unemployed. That means a lower level of unemployment is consistent with stable inflation. In addition, the share of people working part-time because they can't find a full-time job remains close to record highs, and almost half the recent increase in employment has been driven by self-employment, which is now at a record level. The committee's overall assessment is that spare capacity of 1 to 1.5% of GDP remains concentrated in the labor market. The effect of this slack is evident in low wage inflation, which is at around 1%, so Even with weak productivity growth, unit labor costs are rising at an annualized rate of just 0.5 percentage point. Third thing we've learned is that the inflation environment is more benign than we had anticipated. In particular, inflation has fallen from 5% in 2011 back to target for the first time since 2009. Global inflation is subdued, with core inflation in both the euro area and U.S. close to 1%. Commodity prices have fallen, and sterling has appreciated by 10% since its March trough. All of these developments will hold back imported inflation pressures, which have to a great extent explained the above target inflation over the past 5 years. And in addition to all of that, administered and regulated prices now appear likely to put less upward pressure on inflation over the forecast period. The fourth thing we've learned is that the recovery as yet is neither balanced nor sustainable. A few quarters of above-trend growth driven by household spending are a good start, but they aren't sufficient for sustained momentum. Activity is still below its pre-crisis level. Wage growth, as I just said, remains weak, and the household saving rate is likely to fall further. The pickup in business investment is still at its earliest stages. And the global outlook, although improved in the advanced world, entails downside risks in emerging markets. So the question is, what's next? What the MPC has done today is to outline the next phase of guidance, setting out the factors that will guide its decisions and how bank rate is likely to evolve once the 7% unemployment threshold is reached. That guidance has five elements. First, the MPC is for the first time today providing guidance that is seeking to absorb all the spare capacity in the economy over the next 2 to 3 years. That recognizes that spare capacity is both wasteful and that it increases the risk that inflation will undershoot the target in the medium term. Second, the MPC is giving guidance that it judges that there remains scope to absorb spare capacity further before raising bank rate. Third, we're giving guidance that if and when the time comes that the economy can sustain higher interest rates, bank rate is expected to rise only gradually. For a sustained and balanced recovery, the degree of stimulus will need to remain exceptional for some time. The timing and pace of any increase in bank rate will reflect the degree of spare capacity and the pace with which it is being absorbed. The MPC will be monitoring a broad range of indicators, including unemployment, participation in the labor market, average hours worked, and the extent of involuntary part-time working, surveys of spare capacity in companies, labor productivity, and wages. Now, to allow others to monitor how the economy is evolving relative to our projections, today we're publishing for the first time forecasts of 18 more economic indicators. One thing we can guarantee is that future outturns will differ from these forecasts, but publishing them should help others understand our key judgments and anticipate how monetary policy will respond to the evolution of the economy. Now, the fourth thing that we're giving guidance on is that any increases in bank rate should be limited. This recognizes that many of the headwinds holding back the economy will remain in place for some time yet. Public and private balance sheets continue to be repaired. Weak world demand and the appreciation of sterling will hold back the expansion of net exports. And there remain strains in the financial system despite good progress on post-crisis repair. These persistent headwinds mean that, even in the medium term, the level of interest rates necessary to sustain low unemployment and price stability will be materially lower than before the crisis. Now, it's hard to be precise, but one illustration of the possible level of bank rate in the medium term can be derived from the latest forecast of the bank that is based on a market curve which itself approaches only 2% interest rates 3 years from now. In this forecast, inflation is near but a little below target, and the spare capacity gap that we're looking to close, it narrows, but it doesn't quite close. The final thing is that the MPC intends to maintain the stock of asset purchases until the first rise at bank rate. Now, the first phase of guidance was about the conditions that would have to be met before we'd even begin to think about raising bank rate. Now we're outlining what we intend to do, which is to close a spare capacity gap over the next few years, why we intend to do it, which is to keep inflation at target and avoid wasteful spare capacity, particularly in the labor market, and how we intend to do it. First, by waiting to raise bank rate until spare capacity has been absorbed further, and then eventually through gradual and limited rate increases. Bank rate may need to stay at low levels for some time to come. The first phase of guidance gave businesses confidence that bank rate would not be raised at least until jobs, incomes, and spending were growing at sustainable rates. As guidance evolves, that remains the case. The MPC will not take risks with this recovery. And with that, happy to answer questions.
Thanks, Mark. I'd be very grateful if you could identify yourselves before asking a question. Please do wait for the microphone. As you can see, there are lots of you here, so in the interests of as many people as possible getting a question, keep yourselves to a single question, and then hand the microphone back. Hugh.
Thank you. Governor Hugh Pym, BBC News. Last August, you set out a policy on interest rates that was linked very much to one indicator, unemployment. Now you're giving a whole range of different variables. What are borrowers to make of all this?
Well, as I said in my opening remarks, the first thing is that the policy we set out in August has worked. We put that policy in place at a time when the recovery was just beginning, when there was tremendous uncertainty about whether it would have legs. There was the real prospect, in our view, that as it proceeded, that there would be increased uncertainty about the path of bank rate, and that there would be a risk that this would pull the rug out from under the recovery. So in a position at that time when there was uncertainty about the degree of spare capacity in the economy, but there was a high degree of uncertainty that there was still considerable spare capacity in the economy given the performance over the previous 5 years, we made what we would say was a relatively easy call. We said we weren't even going to begin to think about raising bank rates until a certain condition had been met, the 7% unemployment threshold. Now we're in a different place. The economy has been growing strongly over the course of the last couple quarters. We've had the strongest growth in jobs on record. Records only extend back to 71, but still it's been an impressive job performance. And we've taken stock. We move into a phase where we're still looking to maintain the momentum in the recovery, but where we have to make more nuanced judgments. To provide a framework for that, we're for the first time being clear about where we see the degree of spare capacity, particularly in the labor market, that 1 to 1.5%. We're being clear that we see that there's scope to use up more of that spare capacity, and we're being as clear as we possibly can about the nature of ultimate adjustments, which we would all like to see because it'll be a sign of normalization in the economy, ultimate adjustments in interest rates when that point comes. I'll make one last point, which is that this won't be the last discussion about these issues. We've laid out more information than we ever have. My colleagues and I will be back here in 3 months. Hopefully you'll be back here, you and your colleagues will be back in 3 months. I think we're giving something on the order of 20 interviews over the course of now and then. 8 speeches are scheduled between now and then. So, you know, we'll be speaking on average once every 2 days on interviews and speaking once every 5 days. So there'll be lots of opportunity to continue to update how the economy is evolving.
Phil.
Given your forecast was so woefully wrong 6 months ago, what faith should the markets place in these latest forecasts, and how are households and businesses really going to understand what is effectively an output gap target?
Well, I think the first thing is to look at what did we get wrong 6 months ago. And in terms of the forecast for unemployment, there's two components of it. One is the economy has been stronger than we thought. That's a good thing, obviously. I would note that when we sat here in August, we had a forecast that was the upper end of consensus, so we were the most optimistic of forecasters for the economy. Now, the economy was even stronger than we had expected. To some extent, that could have been contributed to by what we did. But the big thing that hasn't transpired that we had expected has been productivity. We had expected that productivity growth would pick up alongside the recovery. And in fact, we thought that if the economy was stronger than we had expected, there would be more productivity matching that. And that hasn't happened. Now, productivity is notoriously difficult to measure, and it's difficult to forecast. What we've done with this forecast is we have been more cautious in our assessment of productivity growth. Productivity doesn't get back to its pre-crisis trend until 3 years from now, till the end of the forecast. And further, when we conduct, there's a sensitivity analysis in the report around productivity, and you'll see in that sensitivity analysis that our assumption of how productivity responds if the economy is stronger or weaker is more conservative. In other words, if it's stronger, we expect less of a productivity response, less endogenous supply, to use the technical term, to develop. And so that builds in some conservatism to our forecast.
The point about households and businesses understanding what is effectively an output gap target, which is about as complex as
economics gets.
Well,
I think the first thing is that we give our assessment of spare capacity. We're giving it to you today. We're going to update that regularly. We're going to have to see continued progress on a broad front, not just for one variable. And we're also providing a medium-term perspective. One of the things we're trying to do here is to provide a medium-term perspective to households and businesses on where rates are likely to go. And I think one of the points we'd like to get across is that we're still operating in quite exceptional times. There are these headwinds that we expect to persist against our economy from abroad, also some of the restructuring at home. The consequence of that is that the medium-term level of interest rates that are consistent with the economy operating at its full potential and inflation remaining at target are materially lower than they were in the past. And we've given one illustration in the report.
Ed Cornway from Sky News. Hindsight is a wonderful, wonderful thing. But had you known that your forecasts on unemployment would have been so woefully awful, would you still have gone for the unemployment threshold you chose 6 months ago, or would you have gone straight to this kind of vaguer, fuzzy forward guidance?
No. Hindsight, if even, I got to say, we've got one of the strongest economies in the advanced world. We've had very strong job growth. We have inflation at target. We have inflation expectations at least as well, in fact, more well anchored than they were in August. If you look at outcomes and the outcomes against which we should be measured, this is a good place to be. We're starting from a good position as we sit here in February, a much better position than we were in August, and certainly a better position than we had been in previous years. If we had dangerous counterfactual, but I'll try to answer it. If we had perfect information about what we would have seen in the economy, then, as we do now, we would have had a greater sense of the degree of slack in the labor market that we've seen, how the labor market has responded to strength. And that might have had some bearing on where we had set the threshold. It might have had some bearing on where we had set the threshold. But of course, we didn't. And the point, part of the point of guidance as we'd set it out, was to learn as we went along the way. Now, we've learned as we went along the way. We've got to a position where we didn't expect to at this point in time. In other words, we expected, my answer to Phil on the productivity side, we didn't expect to be here at this point in time, but we've learned things. And as a consequence of that, when we take our broader assessment, we can provide the type of guidance that we've done today.
Does
Without question, if I knew then everything we've seen now, absolutely would have had a threshold, provided a very clear, clean message, simple message to businesses, message they understood, message to which many of them responded, it's helped reinforce the recovery.
So as I said, can you keep it to a single question? Yes. We've got a lot of you to get round. Larry.
Larry Elliott of The Guardian. You're obviously going to go out and about to explain this new form of forward guidance. So if I'm a member of the public, come up to you on one of your visits, and I say to you, the Bank of England failed to spot the last housing bubble. It failed to spot how quickly the economy was going into recession. It failed to spot the fact the economy was going to flatline for 2 years. It's now failed to spot that unemployment has come down as quickly as it has. Why on earth should I, a member of the public, believe a word you say about the amount of spare capacity in the economy and what that means for interest rates?
Well, I'd flip it around. The Bank of England saw that the recovery was going to gain momentum, took steps to reinforce that momentum. It's worked. And we're taking steps to ensure that it continues to work. I'd say as well that my predecessors, many of whom are here and can speak for themselves on this, saw that there were a series of one-off, largely external price shocks that the MPC should work through when some suggested they shouldn't, should look through. They did, had the courage of the convictions, and kept policy where it should be in order to help set the stage for this recovery. So on the big calls, when the economy was turning with the momentum, whether to look through one-off external price shocks, and including the tactical calls around how quickly to get bank rate down, whether or not to engage in large-scale asset purchases, and to provide guidance that, again, I'll come back, that understood by people who make hiring and spending decisions, that's reinforced their confidence in the recovery, that has assisted in delivering a recovery, that about which we are not complacent. We're pleased to see it, but we're not complacent, and that we're looking to reinforce. That's why, Larry.
Lady Hill.
Emma Charlton from Bloomberg News. Your quite bullish assessment of growth has pushed the pound up quite a lot. And what do you think that means for exports and for the rebalancing? I noticed you touched on that. Could you expand on that a bit more, please?
Yeah, well, there's two issues there. In terms of the challenges to this recovery, and in terms of specifically rebalancing, the net export, clearly the export performance, net export performance is the most difficult. We have, and that is a product of several things. It's the weakness of our main trading partner, which we expect, you know, we see two-sided risks now for the first time in a while around European growth, but still at quite modest levels. So we don't expect to be get relief from our from the demand side any point soon. There is the persistent strength of the strength of sterling, which I referenced, which adds to those challenges. But really, there's underlying this issue of whether productivity is going to start to pick up and when, the extent to which business investment responds to the recovery, and the response of business investment, which we think is a reasonable forecast, is also quite important to the dynamics of growth. And we're going to find out over the course of this year. We've seen early signs of a pickup, but we'll see to what extent that pickup is reinforced.
Ben Chu from The Independent. Governor, the markets expect the first rate rise to come in about April 2015. Last year you said that market expectations of the first rate rise were unwarranted. Are they still unwarranted, or have the markets got it about right now?
Last year we didn't say that. Last year what we noted was a change in market conditions. It was a change relative to a change in fundamentals. So it was a comment on change on change. Which was quite specific. So I don't think we should reinterpret what we said back then. Look, I'm not going to, we were specifically not giving time contingent guidance. We're giving state contingent. We're providing as much clarity as we can We'll continue to do that in coming days, weeks, months, quarters, years, potentially, as necessary to secure the recovery.
Chris. Chris Giles on the Financial Times. Given that the first phase of guidance was supposed to last for the medium term and lasted 6 months, can you explain to the public how this second phase of guidance is going to last and when we should expect it to evolve again?
Well, the first phase of guidance, as you know, Chris, wasn't time contingent. It was a condition in the economy, specifically the 7% unemployment threshold. That was the point at which we would reassess. That's exactly what we've done. In fact, to some extent, we're relying on our forecast in reassessing in February. We could have waited until May, but we figured that there would be more. It would be more helpful and to be more transparency to anticipate the likelihood of achieving that threshold over the course of the coming weeks and months. So we provided that. We're in a situation where there is notable spare capacity in the economy. We put figures around that. We built up that assessment of spare capacity through the labor market where we think it principally lies. We'll all watch the evolution of that, and we'll be commenting on that. We think that we can draw down that spare capacity further before there's any need to adjust bank rate. And I would say that medium-term forces, the types of forces that are weighing on the longer-term equilibrium or medium-term equilibrium level of interest rates, are unlikely to dissipate anytime soon. The forces of balance sheet repair, the changes in the financial system, as two examples, the weakness, persistent weakness in the euro area, are all likely to be with us for some time, and we will continue to calibrate our thinking around that.
David.
David Smith, Sunday Times. The report says that in the central case, slack or spare capacity is not fully absorbed over the forecast period. You've also offered some medium-term guidance on the pace of any tightening and talked about 2017. Does that mean that you have some sort of threshold about the amount of spare capacity at which it will be appropriate to begin thinking about tightening policy? In other words, 1 to 1.5% you think is too much spare capacity, but how close to full capacity do we have to be before it becomes a case for tightening?
Well, let me say the headline, which is that we want to eliminate spare capacity over the forecast horizon. And for the first time, we were being clear about the degree, our assessment of the degree of spare capacity. But I want to pass to Charlie. Yeah,
I think it's reasonable to expect that you would want to start tightening policy before slack is completely eliminated, simply because of the lags between changing monetary policy and its impact on activity. If you leave it until slack has closed, that's a recipe for going too far, if you like. So. We have to factor in those lags between changing monetary policy and its impact on the activity and its impact on activity. On top of that, you have to obviously to take account of the risks of getting things wrong either side. If you tighten too early, there's a risk of foregoing some of the endogenous productivity gains that you might get to the extent that those mechanisms are there. If you leave it too late, there's a risk of inflation expectations becoming dislodged if inflation takes up too much. So they're the sort of judgments monetary policy committees, monetary policy committee members always have to take on board.
Helia.
Helia Ebrahimi, CNBC. I just wanted to pick up on Phil's second part of Phil's question. You said forward guidance is a success, most notably even if unemployment was the wrong metric, at least business understood it. Given today you haven't decided on an explicit time contingent and you have 18 new key metrics, how do you think business will understand forward guidance or where rates are set to be?
Let me take a few things out of your question. I certainly did not say unemployment was the right metric. was the right metric. It was clear, easily understood, widely reported, doesn't get revised, gives an indication of slack being used up in the economy. So I didn't say it was the wrong metric. It's the right metric. And it worked because it provided a clear message to businesses. We are, and the second thing, I'm just the two things that you said, which were not accurate. We're not providing 18 metrics that are some sort of analog to an unemployment threshold. We are providing much more detail about our forecast, everything ranging from detail on the international forecast to our expectation on incomes to the demand components of GDP. All that is now being being provided. And as I said, just being clear, those forecasts, you know, the outturns will be different from those forecasts. That much we know. There'll be shocks and other developments in the economy, but people will be able to update. In terms of the message to business, the message is that we're going to set an appropriate path for monetary policy so that jobs, incomes, and spending continue to grow at sustainable rates. That means that for the present, we've got spare capacity in the economy. We don't need to adjust bank rate. It means that when the point comes, and there'll be many conversations between now and that point, and lots of communication, businesses are pretty good listeners and they seem to understand messages quite well. But when that point comes, that the adjustments in rates will be gradual and they'll be limited. And there's reasons that are spelled out, but the core of that message is we're going to set an appropriate path so that this economy continues to grow. And what is not going to take the risk with the recovery, with sustained momentum, is going to be a sharp adjustment of monetary policy.
Gentlemen, okay. Mario Blaszczak, World Business Press. Mr. Governor, I have a question. While in the second half of 2013, the MPC members viewed sterling's appreciation as offsetting the inflationary pressures, December minutes expressed some concerns about any further appreciation. So I would like to know what is your view of any reversal in sterling's performance to your positive CPI projections given the inflation report from today.
Well, the first thing to note is that if we look farther back, as I think I said in my opening remarks, sterling's appreciated about 10% since the March trough. It's appreciated against a wide range of currencies. Clearly, it's an important, it's always an important relative price in the economy. It has an impact on both activity through the export channel, net export channel, and on inflation. We'll tend to look through the one-off level effects on inflation. Tend to take a relatively conservative pass-through assumption for movements in the currency. In other words, small movements in the currency, we don't immediately pass them through because there are threshold effects in terms of how businesses choose to pass on movements. But the movement has is having an influence clearly on the net export side. It's one of the factors that is helping to hold down import price inflation over the course of the forecast. I would note that in our forecast with the market curve that we are in a position where inflation is close to target but slightly below by the end, even with the strength of the growth in the economy, and even with a more conservative assumption that we have made about the response of the productivity side of the economy.
Hugo Duncan from the Daily Mail. Governor, you say that you are trying to give a bit of guidance on where rates are likely to go and that any rises will be gradual and limited. The market thinks the first rate rise will come in April 2015 and rates will only have got to 2% around 2017. Do you think they've understood your message and that is what you would classify to be likely to happen as gradual and limited rate rises?
Well, what we're not doing is publishing a path of expected interest rates.
And the reason we're, I should say just parenthetically, we talked about that in the summer when we thought about guidance, and we saw a variety of reasons why that is not our preferred strategy. So in response to a clever question, I'm not about to then reveal a path. Just to be clear, what I can say is that if, again, I'd appeal to our forecast based on market rates, which I think you've described, and in that forecast, we don't quite achieve our objective of closing the spare capacity gap, and inflation is around target, it's slightly below, and you can draw your own conclusions from that.
Guy.
Guy Falconbridge, Reuters. I wonder if we could move away from forward guidance Mark 2 and ask you about Scotland. If Scotland didn't get a formal currency union, how would you feel about Scotland perhaps continuing to use the pound? And are there any risks from that for the rest of the United Kingdom's economy? Thank you.
Probably won't surprise you that I'm not going to engage in the hypothetical. What we will do under any circumstance is to the best of our ability discharge the remit that we are given by the democratically elected authorities, relevant democratically elected authorities, we enter into the realm of hypotheticals in terms of what that remit would be, but we will execute whatever we're given.
Tim.
Tim Wallace from City AM. Governor, you mentioned that rates will only rise slowly once they do start to go up, and that markets expect that in the medium term they'll still be well below pre-crash levels. Do you ever, and possibly even several years beyond that medium term, do you ever expect rates to return to what were once considered normal rates before the financial crisis?
Yeah, I think the question of where, and this is something that I'm certain we will be speaking about, whether MPC members or bank staff, in terms of research in coming months. What are the forces affecting, you know, the long-term natural interest rate? And you move into issues of demographics, savings, investment balances, the wide range of issues, the underlying productivity of the global economy, returns in the global economy as well. It partly depends on what the broader policy response is to the extraordinary circumstances we all find ourselves into. If we end up in a world of closing barriers, whether it's to goods or to finance, that will have a material impact, obviously, on the longer term path of rates. But there is nothing to. I wouldn't be a pessimist about the ability to return to the type of rates that historically had been associated with periods of price stability and reasonable productivity growth. But that is, in our view, well beyond the forecast horizon of the Bank of England, and which is why it's been appropriate for us to give the guidance we've given today. I would say further, and I just appealed to something I said in a speech in January to the CBI in Switzerland, which was that if you look at what's the relevant rate for the stance of monetary policy, so the equilibrium interest rate, that certainly went negative during the crisis, which is why central banks had to do extraordinary things above and beyond getting just to the zero lower bound. That to provide effectively lower than that negative interest rate during the crisis. As things heal, that's rising towards zero and eventually turning positive. But the guidance we're giving is that by the end of the forecast horizon, we think it's going to be, even if things proceed, it will be materially below where it was in the past.
Graham.
Yes, Graham Hiscott from the Daily Mirror. A big issue for many families is the ongoing cost of living squeeze. When do you think that wages will begin to match or even surpass inflation? this year, next year, and also the issue for many public sector workers who are seeing much smaller wage increases or even pay freezes.
An important question. I'll say two words and then pass to Spencer. We have seen negative average hours, average weekly earnings, growth in the recent past. We have seen, if you look at disposable income per head, which is more our preferred measure for forecasting, very soft growth over the course of the last 5 years. And we do expect a turn in those this year. But I'll ask Spencer to go through in more detail.
Certainly. So in the one of the 18 variables that the governor referred to is we publish a profile for what we expect to happen to average weekly earnings growth. And what we expect to see is that growth pick up during the course of this year and by the end of this year to be growing more quickly than inflation. So in terms of real earnings, we expect real earnings to go positive hopefully sometime in the second half of this year, although that does depend in part on the pickup in productivity coming through. So a key reason why earnings growth has been so weak is because productivity has been so weak. And so a key feature of what we want to see as the economy progresses is a pickup in productivity growth, that leading to an increase in real incomes and hence providing a more sort of durable basis for the recovery. But we expect real earnings to start to become positive by the second half of this year.
Gentlemen at the back.
Governor Carney, Jonathan Ferro, Bloomberg Television. I understand you don't want to give time contingent forward guidance, but nonetheless businesses will want to plan for this year. Can you rule out a rate hike this year?
That would be giving time contingent forward guidance.
Over there.
Thank you. My name is Mikio Sugeno. I'm from Nikkei, Japanese Comic Daily. I'm just wondering whether you would have any thought for banks better communication with the market and the businesses, for example, holding more press conference like the ECB or BOJ doing monthly. And do you think still as current way is appropriate? Thank you.
Yeah. Well, to the second question, which was whether the current rate and stance of policy is appropriate, yes, the MPC thinks the current stance of policy is appropriate. The minutes will come out next week, and you can read in more detail why that's the case. In terms of communications, I mean, we're always open to suggestions on how to further improve our communications, but, what we have tried to do with these types of events, if you will, has been to consistently increase the amount of information and provide the context. So we've moved earlier last year, but this time last year, I think Spencer was putting in the key judgments. We provided more detail around the key judgments that drive our forecast. We have look back analysis. We did this in November of where we got things wrong and decomposed where our forecasts were, the evolution of the economy was different from our forecasts. We have scenario analysis in here, particularly around productivity, but we'll consistently do that to look at different scenarios, how the forecast would change. We're providing these additional variables. We'll listen to people's perspectives on what else we could provide. That isn't just a dump of information, but it's providing real context. So that's the first thing. Second thing, on availability and answering questions, obviously we have these press conferences, and it's most useful to have these. I mean, we have 12 meetings a year, but I think it is most useful to have these when we have a forecast, and then it's a much richer discussion, as you see with the questions today. But I do press conferences after all my speeches. I think it's only fair that journalists are able to ask specifics about events of the time, but also about the speeches to make sure it's understood. We've done social media things. Spencer has been interviewed on Twitter. He's going to be interviewed in the middle of the night tomorrow morning. It's my understanding. Again, we'll take feedback and guidance, but I think this is a pretty open institution, and there are many opportunities for us to be questioned by journalists, and as well, there are institutional opportunities that come with our responsibilities to Parliament. So we are quite frequently in front of parliamentary committees answering very detailed questions.
Lady.
Good morning, Sue Chan from The Telegraph. Governor, you touched briefly on why you decided not to go down the sort of Fed dot chart, Riksbank style of publishing the path of interest rates. Could you just explain why, a bit more detail on why you thought that was unwise? And also, were there any other options on the table in your discussions?
Well, it's two things. We did have extensive discussions over the course of the summer of different forms of guidance, and so those were very much relevant as we got to the end of phase one. We did discuss different things we could have done here. I'm very comfortable with what we've done. I shouldn't speak for other members of the committee, but I think there's strong support for what we've done. The issue with providing a path, let's do the Riksbank type path. My personal view on the issue around providing that is that you're not providing your reaction function, you're providing a combination of your reaction function and your forecast of the economy. So it's a path of rates if the forecast turns out to be true. I mean, of course, it's recursive, the two are related, but it doesn't provide as much information because when things change, you'd have to come back and then just update your path of rates. Whereas what you saw with guidance, the guidance phase one, is that people in the market, some of you had different views than the MPC did about when that threshold was going to be reached. It's interesting, nobody actually had the view that looks like to be accurate in the end, that it'll be reached in, you know, basically the first quarter of this year. But different people had different views, and that allowed them to express those views because we had said that that was a condition before there were action. Now, we're giving sense on where spare capacity is, that we think we can use up that further. We're pointing to obviously a broader range of variables, but variables we will be updating as we go along, and we will further, as we not just the performance of those variables, but what they tell us about the underlying slack in the economy. And if I can finish with one final point on this, I think we have to remember that we're in a process of moving from an exceptional period, a big dislocation in this economy because of the financial crisis, and ultimately the objective is to get back to some form of equilibrium. Now, there's two forms of equilibrium. There's the medium-term equilibrium, which is relevant to the forecast horizon. We want to close that spare capacity, and we keep inflation at target. But there's the longer-term equilibrium. If you look specifically at the labor market, it is not clear, and we said this in August and it holds true today, it's not clear that there's any reason why the longer-term natural rate of unemployment, for example, has moved materially from where it used to be pre-crisis, 5%. Now, you have people out of work for a long time, you get dislocation, you get hysteresis, you have a variety of factors, and we have to operate over the right time horizon for monetary policy. But it means that we need to keep updating about how quickly we're moving back to that.
Adam Parsons from Radio 5 Live. Spencer Dale, don't worry, it's not in the middle of the night. It's 5:30 in the morning. Governor...
Does he live in the BBC studios?
5:30 is the start of a working day for all of us. 3.4% is a pretty bullish GDP figure, lots of positive data around. Seems like growing confidence. But you said in your opening remarks, not yet a balanced or sustainable recovery. Do you think we're in danger of taking recovery for granted?
Yeah, let me make a couple of points. We're not complacent about this recovery at all. We were serene about... serene but not complacent. I mean, we're serene about where the stance of monetary policy should be. We've got additional spare capacity. We can use it up further. Don't need the adjustment in rates, et cetera. But we're not complacent about the recovery. It's very important that there's the handoff to business investment this year. That's only just starting. We need to see that productivity come in to validate wage expectations and ultimately to give us a boost on the net export side. The third point I want to make is we should actually stop for a minute and talk about that 3.4% and just make sure that everybody's on the same page in terms of what an annual average growth rate is and how important the performance of the economy in Q3, Q4 of 2013 is mechanically to the number in 2014. Because I'm sure everyone here understands that, but I'm not sure everyone who follows the bank less closely would fully understand the mechanics of annual average. So, Spencer, do you want to?
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah. So the so the annual average growth we have for 2014 is around 3.4%. So just remember, to teach people to suck eggs, when you calculate an annual growth rate, it compares the average level in one year compared to the average level in another year. So if the growth is very strong at the end of a previous year, you get sort of quite a benefit just from the handoff. So because growth was very strong in Q3 and Q4 of last year, even if output was entirely flat throughout the whole of 2014, that annual average growth rate would be in excess of 1%. So even if you had no growth this year, just when you compare the average level this year with the average level of last year, you'd get growth of over 1%. So when you see that 3.4%, some of it reflects the fact that we expect the economy to continue growing very strongly this year. But about a third of it reflects the fact the economy grew quite strongly in Q3 and Q4 of last year. And just in terms of the arithmetics, that gives you quite a bit of boost.
Yeah, thanks.
So. Yes, hi, Governor. I wanted to ask also a couple of questions around this not balanced or sustainable recovery. Over the last 10 years, the current account deficit has been a pretty reliable indicator of trouble to come in the global economy. And the UK, in the third quarter at least, had the biggest current account deficit it's had for 20 years. So I'd be interested to know how the MPC thinks about that. And secondly, I'd just be interested if you could elaborate a bit more what you think is actually going on in the jobs market, because, clearly the public sector has shed an enormous number of jobs over the last few years, which suggests that the private sector's productivity growth has been even weaker than the headline figures would suggest. So, what on earth do you think is going, what on earth do you think all these new people are doing if they're not producing any output? Why are they being hired? I'd love to know what your thoughts were on that. And then just finally, if this is a balanced and unsustainable recovery, could you give us any examples from the global economy that would give us confidence that macroprudential policy works?
God.
There's three questions.
My God, how much time do we have for this? Do you want to pick two of the three?
Pick one, Sam.
Yeah.
You can ask the unbalanced and unsustainable recovery. How about that one?
Okay. Two aspects of that. The current account deficit, part of what has happened, it is notable, and the MPC has noted it and discussed the size of the current account deficit, first point. And obviously there's an element of that which is on the trade side, and it's the weakness in Europe, but a big part of the deterioration over the course of last year has been in the net investment position. The net investment position hasn't changed, but at the income side has shifted. And it's hard to be absolutely precise about why, but given the stock of foreign investment of the UK, part of this is probably being driven by the weakness in Europe and the weakness in returns in Europe that is hitting things. So there will be, if that's the case, there should be prospectively, in terms of change, some recovery of that as Europe has stabilized and to the extent it improves. I wouldn't expect a sharp adjustment there. But it does underscore the importance, and we're absolutely upfront about this, the importance of productivity picking up. That requires business investment, both for the net export side and ultimately current account sustainability. So that's clearly there. On the people are producing output, just very clearly, the people are being hired, they're producing output. They're not becoming radically more productive in terms of their production of output, but labor is being priced into the job market. Now, a lot of those people who are working are involuntary part-time, I would underscore. So there is, as a consequence of that, room for additional slack. But to get back to balance, I'd work backwards from productivity, which is notoriously hard to mention because it matters for the current account. Ultimately, as Spencer says, matters for wages, where wages are going to evolve, and the sustainability of consumption growth. And it's one of the reasons why, while we have strength in consumption in the near term with an adjustment in the savings rate, further adjustment in the savings rate, as you move out the forecast, consumption growth is modest relative to historical trends because of the wage side.
Bettina Schulz, Frankfurter Allgemeine. Governor, the recovery in the UK and in Europe came after the risk of a breakup of the Eurozone receded, and that was also because the ECB announced the OMT program or possible OMT program. How has your risk assessment of the Eurozone changed after the German Court of Constitutional Court referred the case to the European Court of Justice?
Well, let me say two things. I'd ask Paul Fisher to comment on constitutional law. No, just to maybe on the sort of impact OMT and funding, if you can give a bit of a perspective on that. I'll say two things, though. One is that, as I think I said, in Scotland, we're not constitutional lawyers at the Bank of England. We're certainly and that held for the UK. It certainly holds a fortiori for Europe in European law. So we don't have particular insight about the referral to the ECJ and what that means. In our forecast, though, we do have, for the first time in a long time, two-sided risks around European growth. So we think there has been some progress in rebalancing, notable progress in rebalancing in Europe. There is some progress on financial repair there as well. I know President Draghi quite defer to him, has described the recovery there as weak, uneven, and fragile, but there is the prospect of the possibility of European growth being a little stronger as well as a little weaker. But the constitutional things kind of are ultra vires for the Bank of England. But Paul, if you can say just a word or two on.
I think it would be quite handy to look at chart 1.2 in the inflation report, which is on page 13, which shows Spanish and Italian bond yields relative to German bond yields. And you can see since the middle of 2012, quite a dramatic fall in the spread of essentially European periphery debt over German debt. And this is on the market's expectation that the Eurozone will do whatever it takes to keep the euro together. We are seeing increased capital flows into those countries. And this is despite the wobble in emerging markets that we've seen during the last month or so. We've actually seen those spreads continue to tighten throughout that, concern about what's happening overseas. So at the moment, there is market confidence in the future of the euro based around the ECB's programme. I think if you listen to the political and economic leaders throughout Europe, they remain committed to the European project, and that's fundamentally what the confidence is based on. Now, obviously, it's a long road for them. They've got a lot of changes to do. And how they go about that is a matter for them to comment on. I think we shouldn't try and get in the way of what our German colleagues and others are trying to do around particular programmes. But that commitment remains. That's what market confidence is based on. And it is helping, at the moment, those countries who most need it.
Gentlemen, Asa Bennett from the Huffington Post. Governor, I just wanted to ask about forward guidance, particularly when in your inflation report you say that the unemployment threshold was widely understood, when of course in the past the bank has said that, has warned of the dangers of the vague language, saying that it wouldn't be misinterpreted by people. So are you confident that it won't be misinterpreted by businesses and the wider community? And can you guarantee that this version of forward guidance of a longer shelf life, there won't be a forward guidance 3, for example?
Well, there's a couple of things. One, the objective is not to have forward guidance forever. The objective is to have a recovery that moves into an expansion that is a sustainable expansion, sustainable and balanced expansion. That's the objective. You know, Nobody's having. No, we're not enjoying this period of. Do you enjoy the last 5 years?
Not particularly.
You're doing a good job. So this is. It was first about securing a nascent recovery. Now it's about. You know, it's taken hold and proceeding. The message into businesses to households is that bank rate is going to follow a path that is consistent with jobs, with incomes, and with spending growing at sustainable rate. And we're going to calibrate it carefully. We're not going to take risks with this recovery. Ultimately, if the recovery proceeds, there will need to be an adjustment, adjustments in bank rate. Those will be gradual. Those will be limited. But they'll be appropriate to secure that recovery, or to secure that expansion. You know, we again, last point on it, we want to move from the recovery phase to the expansion phase and make sure that expansion is durable.
Now, I'm afraid that we have run out of time, so on that note, I will thank you all very much indeed for coming along this morning.